Hey folks, so this video is going to be a bit about detailing in a way, and dry brushing, and then maybe some pigments and dirt. But I'm going to try something I haven't done before. I don't know if it'll work, but I guess we're going to find out. Normally I would do something that I'm about to do with pigments, water suspension pigments, like a clay wash, but I'm going to try doing it with oil paints and see how well it works. I am somewhat dubious about it, but well, I guess we're going to see how it goes. Okay, so right now I'm going to do a little bit of detail work on the Fahrgestahl. Mostly it's just some grease stains. That's what I'm going to do. So I got it's lamp black oil paint from Winsor Newton here. And I've got some terpenoid that I'm going to use rather than the mineral spirits that I have been using. And the reason I'm using the terpenoid is mostly because I'm sick and tired of the smell of the mineral spirits. They stink quite a lot. And I got tired of the smell. So this is lamp black mixed with a little bit of raw umber. So it's kind of a blacky brown color. And I'm going to use it to put some stains here, fuel stains, around the fuel ports. So I'm going to make a couple of long lines just underneath the fuel ports. With my brush. I don't know if you saw that. Then I'm going to grab some thinner. And I'm going to, maybe less thinner, and drag that down. So it makes a streak. It's a little bit difficult to get in here because the wheels are in the way. So that's all I'm going to do there. There's another one here on the back. There above the muffler. And this one here, I'm just gonna have it so it's caught in the little flange here. So I apply it, and then I use the thinner to flow it around a bit. That's about it for there. I'm going to do a little bit on the tension adjuster rods or bolts. I think that's all I'm going to add. It's a pretty simple thing. There's nothing else that I would want to add it to. It's not a particularly greasy vehicle. All right, so the other thing that I want to try, and this is going to be a pretty big risk for me. I may end up ruining this. Oop. So I've got this is going to be like a like a coal bunker. I'm going to fill it full of coal and have a fella shoveling it out. At least that's my plan anyway. And I want to add like a dust to it. So I'm going to try this. It's the Abteilung oil paint. And I'm going to thin it and then use it like a wash. Oh man, look at all that linseed oil. Holy shit. There's quite a bit of linseed oil in there. Jam. Alright, I'm going to grab some. Thinner. That didn't look like it mixed very well. Now this, the Abteilung stuff is, this is light mud. But I'm going to use it to be like dust, I guess. Nice and thin, good. We'll see how well this goes. So I want this to stain this like it's as if it was accumulated dust. So this is an experiment, and I do this quite frequently in my work. I'll take a piece that isn't essential, and then I will use it as a guinea pig for a new product that I want to try, or a new material that I've created, or a new method that I read about or thought about or whatever. I want to give it a try and see how well it goes. So I am assuming that I can brush this on just like any other oil wash, and then I can go at it with a cotton bud or a brush and thin it or clean it up just like I can with any other oil wash. But like I said, this is an experiment to see if this looks dusty. If it works, I might use it as a dust from now on for certain things. It may end up getting used quite a bit on the dial, the diorama. So, if it does work, I'll end up using it on the Fahrgestell as well. All right, so I'm going to let that dry and then see what happens. Now, I really don't have a whole lot of experience with Abteilung. I don't use it very often just because I just don't like how much linseed oil is in it. I find it too runny. I find the paints themselves too soft. And so I find using them for certain things, just, I don't know, I find it difficult to work with, so I prefer not to. I like the oil paints to be thicker. Now, that doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with Abteilung. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is my preference is for thicker oil paints. It's because that's what I'm used to. I've been using oil paints for a very, very, very long time. So it's, like I said, it's what I'm used to. Okay. So that's that. Now, what I am going to do on this is going to be a clay wash. I just have to get it out, though. I'll be right back. Okay, so I've got two ways to do this. I can either use a liquid form, or I can use dry pigment to do this. Dry pigments are a little quicker and probably more accurate and do less of the paintwork would get obliterated, I guess, for lack of a better word. It doesn't actually get obliterated. What happens is this is more intense and dry pigments less intense. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do wet on the cleated beams, and I'm going to do dry on the tread plate. So that's my plan. Anyway, that way you can see the difference between the two. You can decide for yourself which one you want to do. So it's pretty simple. It's a bit different than if you're doing it on the gloss, because it sticks differently, so it doesn't spread quite as well. This is just a homemade mix, so it's just a bunch of different yellows and light brown colored chalk pastel that I ground up, mixed together. And I called it the dry dirt dust mix. Now, it really doesn't take long for this to dry, a matter of minutes actually. And then I take it off with a stiff bristled brush. And actually what I'm doing is, I'm not actually taking it off, I'm kind of grinding it in. So this is just like liquid applied pigments in a way. And you can actually do sort of a dot filter using this. You can also do kind of a dot filter type effect with the dry pigments as well. You would find a color in your pigments that complements the color, like this is dark gray, so you would find a color in your palette of pigments that complements that, so lighter gray or darker gray. And you would do what I'm doing right now, just basically rub it on, wait for it to dry, but you don't do it like I'm doing now. You would do this. It'd be a smaller effect, and then you would rub that in with a stiff bristled brush, and it stains the paint underneath it with a pigment, and it's something similar to a dot filter. It tends to have a more three-dimensional effect and looks more like grime and dirt rather than faded paint. So it depends on the effect that you're trying to achieve, if you want to use it or not. So it's just another tool in your toolbox. Just trying to get it in the edge. I'll do the other side now. Starting to see the dry, it's drying over here now. But the, like this, since this is just water and suspended pastel chalk, it only takes minutes for it to dry. It's one of the benefits of using chalks. The work time is extremely fast, but that can also be a drawback. If you're going to be doing something, you got to make sure you're got it planned out, because it dry so fast, before you know, you've run out of time to do what you're doing. But it's also very forgiving, so it's something that if you don't like how it looks, you can actually just wash it off with water. Now, that being said, once you take a stiff bristled brush and you rub it on your subject, it does become quite difficult to reverse that, because it's actually ground right into the paint now. So I will say that clay wash is quite forgiving and you can remove it, but there is a point where you can't really anymore, and that's usually once you've like rubbed it in, then it's very difficult, if not impossible, to remove it or reverse what you did. I'm eventually going to do the rest of this thing top and bottom, but for demonstration purposes, I'm just going to do these two strips and the sides, and that way I can show you how it works. The trick will be to see if I have this color in dry pigments. I don't actually have to have it. I have to have something that's kind of close, but one of the good things about dirt, it's not all uniform color. It has different shades and tones. In fact, that's one of the great things about it. It makes it more interesting. Not all dirt is uniform. In fact, sometimes I will do this and wait for it to dry, and then once it's dry, I will go over it with another color that's maybe darker or lighter to add depth. It makes it more look like ground in dirt. It's really not much of an effort for me to do that. I actually have some dark brown that I can use to do that. Water, clean up. Okay, now I'm just going to dry this with the hair dryer so it's a little faster. Maybe a little loud though.
Thank you.
Okay, now where's my brush? Is it down here? There it is. Now I usually use stippling brushes for doing this because they're nice and stiff. So to do this, it's very simple. Can see that. It's just a different stiff brush, different shape. It's good for getting into smaller cracks. The stippling brush sometimes doesn't actually get in there. All right, so that's what that looks like. Now, once that's done, I can take a cotton bud like this and streak it. A little hard on the cotton buds. This usually works better on larger flat planes, like would work well on the tread plate, just because it doesn't have these little cleats. The little cleats are making it a little bit difficult to work with, but what's life without a little challenge? So the reason why you do this is, I mean, you don't have to, but the reason why I'm doing it is because if there's any little tied lines, because I mean, that happens if you use the hairdryer, you tend to get tied lines. It gets rid of them. I don't know how well you guys can see that. That's a lot of colors. And then I'll take the stiff brush, drag it down through again, and it just adds more small lines of abrasion. There. Now, I can add another color, like a darker brown to that, to give it more depth when it comes to color. So it looks like that before. That's pretty painful on the eyes. and it looks like that after. It looks rather well worn. Now, once I finish this whole thing, I will take a, where is it, this, this pencil, and I'm not going to do it all right now, and rub it on these cleats, and it'll bring the shine back up. I don't know if you guys can see that at all. So you see how that works? Pretty simple. It's not very complicated. It's actually quite easy to do. It doesn't take long to do. This is a pretty big subject, so it's, you know, takes a bit of time to do it. But, so that's essentially how you do that kind of pigment work, a liquid pigment work. It's not something I'm going to do on the Ferragostal. The Ferragostal, if I do any pigment work on it, it will be dry pigments or even sprayed on paint. Most likely it's just going to be dry pigments. However, if what I did to that little coal bunker works, I might actually use that. But we'll see. Okay, cotton buds. Try to keep the paper towel out of shot when I'm working, because the paper towel seems to screw up both the autofocus and the white balance on my cameras. Funny, I don't usually have these problems when I'm working over on my build bench, because I'm not dealing with colors, not like this anyway. But over here on the paint bench, this is kind of a new thing for me, because I don't usually film here. Almost all the filming I've been doing for a while has all been at the build bench, in this cave anyway. In the old cave downstairs, I did filming at both. Because it was easy for me to move the camera around. In here, this cave is much bigger, and it was very difficult to move the cameras because the wires weren't long enough. Because I don't do things wirelessly. I'm not that kind of guy. Wireless connections are shit, so I don't trust them. So, filming in here at the paint bench was always a problem, but I recently added another camera to my arsenal of irritating technology. So now I have three of these Logitech 920 shit things, and I got two over them in that build bench and one over here. So filming over here at the build bench, or the paint bench, is kind of a new thing for me. So I'm still working out a lot of the bugs. I mentioned this before. One of the bugs I want to get rid of is that this pixelated line right there. I don't know how to get rid of that. Any of you guys have any suggestions on that? I'd love to hear them. That'd be great. Okay, so that's both sides there done, right? I'm going to do that one later. So I'm going to get some dry pigments. Yeah. Desert sand, I guess, is the winner. Now I made all these myself. Now I need, where's my brush? So, pigments are quite simple as well. Now, I'm using the pigments to stain, not add texture. So I'm adding color, not texture. This is actually pretty close to doing that dot filter that I had mentioned. So I'm adding the pigments randomly. I'm going to have to stop here because my wife just came home with the groceries. I'm going to have to give her a hand. I'll be right back. All right, so back at it. So essentially you're doing, like I said, kind of like a dot filter. So you're adding pigments and kind of a pattern that would emulate collection. So in this case, I should be doing it like the way vehicles would travel it. That's what I should be doing, but I'm not. And my hand is also in the way and you can't see what I'm doing. Let's try this. There, now maybe you can see what I'm doing. All right, so, or not. All right, so emulating like tire marks. Motion of traffic. So in bands. And again, this is not so much a three-dimensional weathering effect. It's a accumulated dust effect. Looking in the wrong drawer, that's why. All right, so now I want really easy. The camera would just move itself. Now you don't need these specific tools that I'm using, these specific brushes. You'd be hard pressed to find them anyway. But you just need stiff bristled brushes, you need old paint brushes, you need one of these big puffy makeup brushes is really good, because I'm about to use it. I have no idea what this is. I mean, I found it somewhere, I can't remember what it is, but I use this. For, because it's stiff and hard, I use it for doing all kinds of pigment stuff. So stiff bristles, right? And long bristles, soft bristles are good for pigment work. I'm just wiping away the loose pigments. Now, another thing you can do, where is my stippling brush? Now, rubber tires tend to polish things. Move my hand out of the way. There. Rubber tire marks. Ta-da. Okay, now I'm just going to do the same thing to the other side, but you guys don't need to see that because it'll look the same. Is what I already did, and it'll be boring. Hopefully, when I come back in the next piece, this will be dry enough that I can tell if it's going to work or not. So it's still a little bit wet, so we'll see how well that's going to go. So I'll be back in a bit, and we'll see this thing completely finished, and see if that if this coal bunker thing is working. So. Right, back in a bit. All right, so I brushed on some of the pigment onto this side here after I, you know, ground it all in, all the liquid pigment in. So I brushed it on and then I fixed it. Now, what I use to fix most pigments is either mineral spirits or I use X20A. I'll also use X20A. And every now and again I'll use terpenoid, but terpenoid doesn't work as well. Mineral spirits seems to work better. I don't know why. It just does. So what I was doing was basically this. What I'm trying to do is build up dirt around the teeth. And then I use the fixer to attach it so it stays there. I mean, it's not bulletproof. It's not like cement or anything like that. I mean, it's strong enough that if I blow on it, it won't move. Or if I touch it lightly, it won't move. But I'm certainly not bulletproof. But it'll do. I don't play with my models. I sit there on the carpet going vroom, vroom, vroom with my tanks. So I don't need them to be super robust. I also don't ship them across the world and sell them and stuff like that. So it's not really it's not one of my priorities to make it that robust. It doesn't need to be. It would need, if I wanted to go to a model show though, it would need to be that strong. It would need to be strong enough to withstand that. And it is. I've taken my models to shows and entered them in competition. And I've had no problems with that. So. So the fixer works well enough for that, and that's all I need it to be. Okay. Now, mineral spirits. Now to add fixer, take a brush and touch. Just touch the highest point And capillary action will take the fixer everywhere. And after a minute or two, if you notice there's spots that don't have fixer mounted to it, then you just go back and touch it again and it'll be no problem. So easy peasy. It takes about, 20 minutes for it to dry. So you have that long to notice. If you haven't noticed by then, you're going to have to start over again because you won't be able to see the spot that doesn't have any fixer. Well, you will if you blow on it because your pigment will blow away. That's how you figure it out, I guess. I don't suggest doing that. Now, if you notice, there's lots of gaps there, but it's all filled in up here. That's how it works. You just give it some time. It will eventually find its way everywhere. You don't need tons, just a drop or two. Usually does the job. One thing you got to be careful of is tide marks. There are, I don't know if you can see them. There's tide marks there. There's tide marks there. And the only way I know of to get rid of those is like that. When it's still damp, take a brush. Just give it a rub, gentle rub, and it usually blends it in. So another one up here. That's all you got to do. It's pretty simple. Right, so that is pretty much it when it comes to the pigments. Now, I did mention a few minutes ago about using pigments as a dot filter, but then I didn't actually demonstrate it. I talked about it and said, this is kind of like this, but then I actually didn't show it. So I'm going to do that now. Only takes a minute or two. Clean that out of the way. And I will demonstrate it on this. Okay, so this is large, boring, flat surfaces. And I would like to do a dot filter on it, so I can do that with bits of pigment. Just like I do with actual oils. And then I rub it in. You can do the exact same thing with watercolor pencils. And then I streak it like so. And I can do it with different colors. I can add blues, greens, oranges, rhinoceros piss, whatever color you want. And the more I rub up and down, the more blended it gets. Now I find doing this as a dot filter 1,000 times more forgiving than oils. And it's also faster. So anyway, that is what I'm talking about when I mean you doing a dot filter with pigments. It's literally that fast. It's literally that simple. I don't even have to fix it unless I'm going to be handling that part a lot, which I generally try not to do too much. Gotta do the other side now. Essentially, that's, you don't really have to do anything more than what I just did there. So, again, just up and down, rub it in. You got to do it on flat paint. You can't do it on gloss paint. Doesn't work on gloss paint at all. That's done. I don't know if the camera will pick it up. It's quite subtle. That's before. That's after. So, anyway, I wonder if I have a gray mixed up. Dark gray. This will be interesting. Alright. Now, this is a dark gray. There's a good chance it's probably just going to reverse what I just did. Oh, no, it's lightening it. Ah, it's fading it. I've never actually done this before on a gray before. So now it's weathering it quite extensively. Now, one of the cool things about doing this with a pigment small brush, water. Streaks. See what that looks like in a second or two. See if I can intensify it a bit. Let's try with the cotton bud. I find the cotton buds are a bit more robust. Cotton bud will pretty much take off almost all of it. It will still leave a streak. Yeah, same thing. I don't know if you can see it on there. There's streaks on there, which is exactly what I was going for. So there's light and dark gray streaks on there now. Do the same thing on this side. What is this one? I gotta remember which brush I was using for the pigments. I don't remember. Ah, that's the water. cut what's going on there. My bench is becoming quite chaotic because I'm randomly doing different effects, sort of almost out of order. I don't usually do things like this. Not this chaotically, anyway. There. So, that's what I meant by the dot filter. And it's pretty simple. I find it quite effective. And like I said, you can do the same thing with watercolor pencils. Watercolor pencils are even more precise. You can do smaller effects with watercolor pencils, micro effects actually. So I find them even more precise, though I don't have a great deal of experience with the watercolor pencils. I don't use them very often, which is why I haven't demonstrated them. I don't have a lot of confidence in my skills yet, so it's still a work in progress. Right, so I think I'm done now for this. I don't know how well. It's been a while, so that didn't work out, I don't think. I don't see any appreciable difference, so I might have to make the mix stronger, or I just don't use it. It might actually be my choice. I think I might just stick with what I just showed you, what I do. It's more effective. So anyway, that's all I got for this. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now. Thank you.